Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So yesterday we have completed a few topics related to what are the parameters that are associated with water cycle. And we were studying about porosity, permeability. I stated about porosity and permeability, infiltration, because that are the important parameters whenever you are talking about groundwater reservoir. Whenever you are talking about groundwater reserve, your recharge, your infiltration, all depends on your porosity and permeability of the soil. Like each and every human being has got a different face, shape and size. Like that, each and every properties on the earth, whether you talk about soil, whether you talk about land, whether you talk about rock types, whether you talk about vegetation, has got different properties. So if you know those properties of those species or those materials, you can easily identify, you can easily state the condition, what can be the probable solution in case there is a shortage in that area in terms of water resource, if you are talking in particular. So today's objective for my presentation will be ki how does the porosity and permeability are associated or related to infiltration. So if you see that, what do you mean by porosity? So we'll start up. So this is the zone of map that we have. Why it's happening? Porosity. Okay. Okay. So I'll be wait for a minute. I'll start with this. Yeah, fine. So this is the feature, or this is the figure. Whenever you see any water bearing structures on the surface, you generally we see this surface water that is on the top layer of the soil. Theek hai na? So these are all rivers, water bodies, lakes, ponds, whatever we see. This is characterized as surface water. Surface water means all the water that is above the ground surface will be characterized under surface water, whether that is a lake, whether that is a pond, whether that is a reservoir, dams, rivers, all will be categorized under surface water. Thereafter, you will be seeing this is the demarcated, you can see different types of trees with different shape and size, with different leaf structure. So means that each and every tree has got a different property, and it is indirectly related to their moisture holding capacity, their soil condition, their biomass condition. So all are different for different species. So you can see this is the land surface, the top surface where the different agriculture and vegetation is grown up. That is known as land surface. In between this land surface and the at the downwards, you will see there is a written the water table. There has been written water table. So this is the water table that generally we go for extraction, like in Rajasthan right now. You have limited number of rainy seasons, but that rainy seasons are limited to maybe 15 days or 1 month in the entire year. Means from that 1 month of water, 11th month we have to sustain either for drinking purpose or for irrigation or whatever for livestock. So what, how it will be done? So we have to conserve those water. So what we'll do will be first identifying the different terms, the patterns that are dealt with the groundwater movement. So the top surface of the saturated zone of water, the top surface of the saturated zone of water is known as water table. So whenever you are talking about the underground water table, you are talking about what is the volume of total groundwater available in the subsurface. So this groundwater is the water that is stored beneath the earth, and that is classified or characterized as groundwater. So whenever we are talking about water conservation, whenever we are talking about river mechanism. So we are talking about this groundwater and we are talking about surface water. So there are two kinds of water whenever you are trying to build your career in water resource. You have to preserve two water. One is groundwater and other one is surface water. So both are directly related to surface runoff. As yesterday I told ki how the different surfaces will have different runoff. So until and unless you are not classifying, you cannot visualize ki what is there in the field. You cannot model it up. So the top surface of the saturated zone means the surface or the volume that is totally filled with water. Totally filled with water means like a jar, if I have filled entire jar with the water, that is called as the saturated zone, means the jar will be called as the saturated zone. And the top surface of that jar that is entirely beneath that, that is filled with water, will be classified under the category of water table. And above water table, you have got unsaturated zone. Unsaturated zone means there is an option of infiltration, there is an option of recharge, there is an option of water movement towards the downward movement, and that is the process that we'll to study, and we have to conserve this water. So those movement of water will happen through fractures, rock or sand particles, because in the land or in the earth, you'll be finding soil, you'll be finding rocks, you'll be finding different landforms. Now we have to see ki how this water can be stored in the groundwater so that we can use that water for the other non-monsoon period. So that can happen only through that recharge goes through this fractured rocks or through gravel. So groundwater fills the spaces between the soil particles and fractured rock underground. So what will happen? You will have a water that is occurring, precipitation is there on the surface, the water comes on the surface, then it's moved downwards. This downwards movement of water happens through this fractured rocks, through cracks, joints, lineaments, or through the open spaces in the soil types. So this movement of the open spaces in the soil type will be classified as porosity. So porosity is the amount of open space in a rock. Means until unless you don't have a space in a rock, if the jar, for example, if we closed a Pepsi bottle, if it is closed and I'm just opening my tap to get it refilled, we cannot refill it because its surface is locked. So whatever water is coming on the top of that Pepsi bottle will be flushing it out as a runoff. But if we open the bottle and there is a sufficient amount of open space available in the water, the amount that can be stored will be fully covered up and the rest will be flowing up as a runoff. So that is the meaning of open space in a rock. So the more is the open space in a rock, the more will be the recharge. The lesser will be the space within the rock, the lesser will be the recharge. Means the more is the open in the rock or soil, the higher will be the porosity. The lesser will be the spaces within the rock, the lesser will be, or it will be classified under low porosity. So in case you see there is a rainfall coming up in both the surfaces, because there are open spaces of unequal sizes of particles, the void spaces are equally available. So that's why you will have high porosity over the image that is shown on the left hand side. Whereas you compare on the right hand side, you see that there are small rocks coming up in between these pore spaces. So the amount of movement, the amount of open spaces are less. That's why that is less porous. Porosity means we are talking about porous medium, which medium is more porous than other. So I'll be taking another example about the feature porosity. So porosity varies with amount of sediment. It varies with the amount of sediment. That means the more sediment between the particles, the less pore spaces. It's obviously if I'll be cementing up the material in between the void spaces, and if I'm pouring up the water, because that surface is already cemented, there is no open spaces. So what will happen? The water will flow as a runoff. But in case I have got a porous medium, and if I pour a water, just like a sponge, if you take a sponge and you just put the sponge in a glass, in a bucket that is filled with water, or with a ball that is filled with water, it will absorb all the water. So that is because of the open spaces that are available in that sponge medium. So more is the cement material, less will be the pore spaces. It will be having low porosity. Then again, on the basis of sorting, like if you go in the surface, like on the land, each and every particles may be of not the same material. It can be of different shape and size. It will be of different texture. So well sorted means well rounded soils have more spaces than unsorted soil. So you can see that if it is well rounded, so there the option of spaces is available. And if it is unsorted, the smaller fragments of soil are just locking the open pore big spaces. So what will happen if you have got of different mixes of different materials available in that area, the recharge will be less. It is of the same density, then the recharge will be more, means porosity will be high. Then again, it depends, the porosity depends on your fracturing. Fracturings are the weakest plane along the which there can be a possibility of breakage in the rock, or there is a plus possibility of recharge into the underground water surface. So bedrocks with more fractures or cracks has more pores than bedrocks without many cracks. So obviously, if you have got more cracks, the water will flow through it, and there will be, because the water is flowing through the cracks, through the open spaces, it will take time, it will take the travel time. And when it is traveling through those open spaces, the recharging will be done towards the lower end parts where the underground water, and it will be going and recharging the underground water. But in case if there is a lesser number of fractures or cracks, so you will have lesser porosity, so lesser recharge. So porosity is not affected by particle size. If you can see that you have got of different particle size, but all are having the same porosity. So each container has equal volume of sediments and equal pore spaces. So next come permeability. Now we have done with porosity. Now with permeability, what do you mean by porosity and permeability? They are the two processes on which any movement of water resource in the nature depends on. So next is permeability. So what do you mean by permeability? Permeability is the ability of the water to flow through the soil. So the movement of the water beneath the ground happens due to permeability. Means the more the permeability, means more the pervious surface, more is the recharge. Less is the impervious surface, less is the recharge. So permeability depends on the soil composition, size and sorting. So large particles, and if you have got a small particles, which will have the better sorting, and if you got sorted particles and unsorted particles, which will have better sorting. So now we'll be doing more into the detail. Like if you have got larger particles, if you'll be using it, that will be more permeable, means because there will be more open spaces, means the movement will be more, and that allows the water to flow easily from space to space. If the particle size is small in nature, means less permeability, means what? It's hard for water to find a path through the soil. So if you take both the figures on the left hand side, A and B, you'll see that the water can easily travel in large particle size if you compare that with the smaller particle size, because of its movement, and movement is your permeability. So the smaller particles will have a lesser permeability if you compare that with a larger particle. In the same way, if you have got sorted particles and unsorted particles, sorted particles will be more permeable because there will be a plenty of open spaces that connects to each other. So the more the sorted material means more the open spaces, more the open spaces means more the porosity, more the porosity means more the permeable the surface is. Now, if you talk about unsorted particles, means on a surface, if you have got different types of grainage size, different types of particle size that are available in that area. So, what will happen in case you've got a heavy rainfall? It will be less permeable because smaller particles will fill up with the spaces, leaving little room for water to move. So, because the movement of water will be very slow and limited in nature, that's why unsorted particles are less permeable if you compare with that with the sorted particles. So, the availability, the movement of groundwater depends on what your underground water that we are using for drinking purposes, for different kinds of irrigation purposes, depends on the porosity and permeability of a soil or a rock or a different landforms. For each and every object, you will have a different porosity. For each and every object, you will have different permeability. So, as the water permeates soil, some water molecules get stuck onto the sediments and do not flow through. This is called retention. So, you can see ki like this is a total amount of water that is poured. So, out of 100 mL milliliter of water that is poured, we have got a sediment tube in between it. So, the amount of water that comes out through those sediments to that jar represents the underground water table, that is 87 milligram per liter, okay, milliliters. And the amount retained in this sediments is 13 milliliters. So you can see that nearly because of the similar grain size, there was more porosity and permeability. That's why the amount was 87. In the case there was unsorted material in the same surface and there is an underground surface, so the water output would be too less. So you can see now how the movement of the water happens through this open pore spaces that we see on the ground. Now, the another term that is associated with groundwater is capillarity. Capillarity means the movement of groundwater to the surface, means the ability of the water to rise in small openings. To rise means to come up. Example, water being pulled out into a proper towel. So that is one of example properties. Water is sticking to water, water is sticking to water cups, and this is the another picture. So I'll be showing you the other slides that I have with me, available with me. So now it's clear what do you mean by porosity, permeability? Any confusion? Yeah. Any confusion? Anyone? Can you see the slides?
Yes, sir.
So when we are talking about groundwater, because groundwater is very important. So groundwater is the water stored in open spaces, means beneath the ground. We are talking right now, what we are talking about is the water that is stored beneath the ground within underground rocks and the sediments. Means we cannot see visually, but those water is existing on the earth in different rocks, in different sediments, and that we have to extract for our day-to-day uses. More than 65% of the groundwater used in US is attributed to agricultural needs. Means 70% of water we are using for irrigation purposes or drinking purposes. So until unless you are not recharging this groundwater, because your population is going on increasing, you see the volume is limited. Like if I've got a bucket, like, and there is a water that the tap I am opening, I know ki what is my bucket size. If it is beyond that, it will go as a runoff. And if I go on extracting it without recharging it, without opening the tap, there is a water that is stored. Now I'm going on extracting it for my daily use. So what will happen? Within few hours, it will extinct. So that is the problem that happens in major cities of India, that we are just using it. We are just using for our needs, but we are not taking any initiative. We are not considering or creating any features of recharge sites so that the groundwater in that area increases. So the drought has depleted the supply and the like, and because of that, now increasing population, more production, more irrigation, more water demand, you have to identify the new sources. So if you got no new sources, what will happen? The pressure on a particular surface will decrease. Second one is existing resources must be protected, means the sustainable development concept or sustainability comes into the factor, that we must have all the needs limited in nature so that our resources will be protected, and we'll be using our resources in such a manner that the future generation can also see, can also utilize those resources. Just like our parents, they construct houses, they construct purchases land for whom? They purchases land for their future generation. Future generation are their kids. So in the same way, what we have to do, we have to preserve our mother earth, whether we are talking about forest, whether we are talking about land degradation, whether we are talking about recharging the underground water. So each and every person has got a responsibility. Generally in India, we give all the responsibility to the state government, to the block development officer, to the DC, to the central government, ki there is a water scarcity, you'll start shouting. But I'll ask ki how much forest, how much tree you have planted. I'll ask how much recharge site you have in and around near to your houses. How many sites you have identified where we could have constructed a new recharge site so that the groundwater condition could have developed in that area. No, nobody does, because we think ki this is none of our business. Our business is only to study. Our business is only to get good marks. Our only duties is to earn money. Rest, we are just what, users. We just uses the different products that are obtained from the nature without protecting it, without conserving it, without thinking ki what will happen in your future, without a judicious decision. So now it's the time. You're seeing that in current pandemic, it has shown that even if you money, you have money, you cannot stay, you'll be dead. So the biggest money is your environment. So each and every citizen must take a responsibility to at least plant few number of trees, to at least have few recharge sites in and around their houses or in their mohallas or in their localities, so that the groundwater gets recharged and the environment in and around your where it's doing, you'll be getting sufficient amount of oxygen. Getting it? So we are capable of shaping the landscape. The humans can do anything. If we think, we can do greats. So what we have to do from the starting, we started caves, sinkholes. Okay, getting it? So groundwater and hydrological cycle, as yesterday I have completed most of the, I'm not going into the details, porosity. We'll start again with that portion of the material volume, which is the pore spaces. That is the amount of empty space in rock or sediments that is known as porosity. Permeability is the ability of a material to transmit fluids. That is the degree of interconnectedness of the empty spaces. So you can see this is the open pore spaces. These are filled with some glasses. So porosity is affected by. So on what factors does the porosity is defined? It will be determined on the basis of particle size. It will be defined on the basis of particle shape, shorting of particles, amount of material, cementing the grains together, fractures in the materials, and internal arrangement of particles. So you can see that the different soils have got different porosity, like soil has got 55% of porosity, gravel, different soil like gravel 20 to 40%, sand 25 to 50%, silt 35 to 50%, and clays 50 to 70%. So you can see that as you are going towards the finer material, the porosity is increasing. In the same way, if you go with the porosity like sandstone has got 50 to 30, shale 10 to 0 to 10, solution in limestone, dolostone, it is 10 to 30, fractured basalts 5 to 40%, and fractured granite equivalent to 10% of porosity. Permeability, we have already stated, materials must have both. So if you want to have a good amount of recharge in any area, the both the properties should be available at that area, that is porosity should also be high as well as permeability. So if you go for the stove foams has higher porosity, that makes it good insulated keeps things hot or cold. Styrofoam has low permeability, allows you to keep in liquids in it. Clay has high porosity but low permeability. Means what? Because the particles are very limited and the smaller in size, so the porosity will be there, means the water is going downwards, but permeability is not there, means the water is not going well, or it's not connected, or it's little movement through the clay. Isliye what we'll say, it will be classified under low permeability. So the materials with high porosity and high permeability are unlithified sediments, sands, and gravel. So whenever you will be finding sands, gravel, unlithified sediments, you can say that there is porosity is high and permeability is high. Then you have got lithified segments like sandstone, fractured limestone, fractured granites. So these are some of the features that you must read or you must study whenever you are going for any kind of study in terms of conservation of water resources. So for today we'll be doing till here only, because I'll be not going into the aquifers. Aquifers will be doing separately. Then water table, we have already stated ki what is the saturated zone, what is the water table, what is the unsaturated zone, how this we are living on the surface. Generally this is a well that we are seeing on the surface. So you see ki how this water is being extracted from a well. In the same way we extract the water from tube wells or the different pumping sites. So they extract underground water. So what will happen if you are not recharging the surface, if you are not constructing the different kinds of rain harvesting structures, what will happen? The entire water what is coming as a precipitation will vent off through downward movement through steam slopes and finally will go and emit into the sea. So what our phase is, the emphasis is for the current topic of study, why we are reading it, why hydrogeology has to be a part of your study, because you have to understand the different topics, the different characteristics, the different properties of water that are related to the land surface, how it acts on, how it moves on the surface, how we'll be conserving this water on the surface, what are the technicalities that you have to see whenever you're going for any water harvesting or water construction site, to whom you will be saying that anybody can ask or anybody you will be seeing on the television stating that the officers of your DC, the water table is going downwards. Now what is this water table? So until unless you are not studying the logic, somebody says the underground water table, we have to give spaces to the underground water table. So what does you mean by underground water table? What do you mean by water table? What do you mean by aquifers? Unless you don't have the clear concept, you cannot model it, you cannot protect it, you cannot manage it. That's why today it was an important topic that we covered and discovered was porosity and permeability. Now you know which material is more porous, which material is having high permeability, which material is having lowest permeability, what are the factors, what are the reason, what do you mean by zone of saturation, what do you mean by zone of unsaturated zone, what do you mean by infiltration, what do you mean by water table. From at least now, if you see or somebody is stating ki, we are talking about water table, we are talking about what zone of saturation. Now, if they are asking, so now you can visualize ki, what they are trying to highlight and what are their area of thrust. So that can happen only if you have got a sound in-depth knowledge of the basic parameters that are associated with the movement of water resources. And with this, I'll be ending my today's presentation on porosity and permeability. Okay. And I